What's up, viewers?
Eric's in the chat room.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, I just made him a guest.
Right on. Right on, right on. I think I already did this one. It's related to QT. It's the same kind of QuickTime stuff that my Linux box is having a problem with. But the error that I'm getting on the Linux box is, I can guarantee you, completely different than the one you're getting. I'm getting a permission denied error, and I think this will be good for news. So there
you go. I sent an email to him, and when I talk to the guy tomorrow at the network, I'll
1 minute until showtime.
Worry about it later.
Yeah, I always checked on those. Oh, that's the one I wanted to put up there. I also checked on those stations. That should be entertaining.
Yeah, you got a bunch of new stations to be on. Did you send me the stories?
Yeah, but you got a plus one that's coming to you right now.
Okay.
Are you hearing like an audible like whine?
No, not at all.
My ears must be ringing or something.
I don't drink. That's probably what it is.
Okay. She said 1 minute, and it's been longer than a minute.
Your show will go live in 5 seconds. Oh, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Broadcasting live, it's America's longest-running national radio talk show on computers, Computer America, hosted by national columnist Craig Crossman. Look for Craig's weekly column in your favorite newspaper. This show is being beamed nationwide at computeramerica.com. Keep it here for technology news, computer products, guest interviews, and your phone calls. You're listening to Computer America.
Hello, and welcome into the Computer America Show. It's the nation's longest-running, nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers. Computer America is heard around the world and coast to coast. And I am your host, Craig Crossman.
And I am your co-host, who has got that entire opening sequence down, certified ethical hacker Charles Tendell.
Hey, it's Thursday.
I know. We made it past hump day.
Yes, we did.
We made it to All Friday's Eve.
Yes, we did, and we'll make it there too. You know, and of course we got some news to talk about. First of all, let me just tell you that we are now officially heard live Monday through Friday at this time and this on the IRN Radio Network.
You're doing it wrong. It's the IRN Radio Network.
Yes, the IRN. The IRN Radio Network. Yep, you can hear us live right on the network, and the link is live. If you just go to computeramerica.com, you'll see we are on Blog Talk Radio. We're on the Boost Radio Network, which is new, and I think officially launched yesterday, and also on the IRN Radio Network.
And if you stay tuned, we've got a whole bunch of new announcements that are coming out at some point, too.
Yeah, they're really coming. We got some incredible stuff coming up here, expanding the reach of Computer America further into broadcast radio and satellite. I mean, this is just some amazing. Things are just doing extremely well. And just, you know, here's the thing: just check our website. Whenever you just check our website on a daily basis, you don't have to do it every 10 minutes, but just, you know, at least once in every 24-hour period, go to computeramerica.com. And you'll see all the announcements, all the excitement, everything that's happening at our shows as Computer America continues to grow.
But I think I've got a better way to do that.
What is that?
If they sign up for our show reminder newsletter.
Well, yeah, but you see, that's once a week.
Well, even if it's once a week, they still get some of the greatest announcements in the world, and then they're going to be enticed to come and listen in on the show. They're going to look at the handsome guy on the video.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Oh, no, I thought you meant on the homepage.
You should put the video on the homepage. People would love that. They'd be like, oh, look, it's Charles.
Exactly. That's one of our new features. It's still in beta, of course. But
it's going to be like Gmail. It's going to be in beta for years.
We are adding, we have our video show page right under the archives page. You can see show videos, and you click there, and you'll see all the current videos, including the tonight's show. And then it becomes part of the archive as we continue to do this. Now, as we continue to, fine-tune the videos, right now they're primarily of Charles, Once in a while, he can also direct the video to see what his computer is displaying.
Mm-hmm. We're definitely going to do that during this episode.
Yes, that's very nice. Also, I'll be joining in on the video conferencing in a short time, and then our guests also will be invited to be on the videos as well. So you can not only listen to us, you can watch us and see us. It's kind of creepy, you know. I'm watching you. It's like the NSA.
You got to be careful, man. They've been cracking down on a lot of people lately.
Yeah, they're watching.
Oh, wait, I'm still invisible. Oh, there we go.
That's right. You just unghosted yourself, so now you're in the chat room.
I know. I kind of like being a ghost. I'm a digital ninja.
That's it. So that's all up and running, but we're going to be adding all those additional accents, if you will, or features to the show videos as time progresses, as it continues to evolve into, you know, something really, really terrific. Although it's great now, but it's going to get better and better. But
it's like Google Glass. There's nowhere to go but up.
That's right. And we had to talk about Google Glass. You got your new prescription glasses.
I did. Again, the shipping monkeys over at Google amaze me. So my Google Glass, if you're watching the video, I don't have them on my head because they're behind me and they're charging. But so Google finally came out with the biggest complaint of all is we those of us who are optically challenged.
Uh-huh.
You know, we have trouble. You know, we had to choose between being you know uber cool wearing our Google Glass and enjoying that experience and getting you know real time data to our face, okay. You know, and being able to see that real time data to our face. Uh-huh. So we had to take our glasses off or wear the Google Glass over top of our glasses. And Google 2 days ago, uh-huh. 2 or 3 days ago, and I think we covered this story on the show. Announced that they had developed their own custom line of glasses. And me being the geek that I am, and after the glaring looks from my wife because I had to whip out the credit card, I went ahead and I ordered mine. And again, the shipping monkey, like I ordered them last night, they showed up this morning, and I was like, wow.
All right.
And, you know, we got my glasses, my prescriptions together. We went to a place here in town. They're not yet, but they're about to be an authorized a Google Glass, you know, optical place, so that you can get that stuff on there.
Yeah.
Then they had to ship them off. They'll be back in a few days with my prescription in these really cool looking Google Glass frames, and I am excited because now they really kind of blend in and they look like normal glasses, and I don't look like so much of some sort of super spy.
Yeah, but you might want that. You don't want to go incognito.
Well, you should ask
oh, well, tell us about
I
that.
I should just have my wife follow me around with the iPad and the microphone to do these videos because we got jumped walking into the optometrist. There were the people sitting in the lobby who were looking at me like, "What's he got on his face?" You know. And then everyone that worked there, which by the way, interesting, you know, trivial piece. Everybody that worked in this office wore glasses.
Well,
I was like, but all of them were wearing glasses. Like, this is interesting. There were no contact. No, if they were wearing contacts, you know, I didn't really notice it. But everybody working there wore glasses. But everybody there was like, "Are those what I think those are? Are those Google Glass?" Everybody, and you know,
good though, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. But like every little, like just showing them that you put them on. Like, I have to unlock mine because, you know, the hacker in me wants it to be, you know, somewhat secure.
You like being the center of attention, let's face it.
Of course. I'm the co-host of the nation's longest-running, nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers and technology. Of course I want to be the center of attention.
My name, Charles Pendel, is inviting me to join this hangout again here.
I'm always inviting you. I'm getting into the habit of inviting both the guest and you, mm-hmm. even though you're not ready for it.
But, you know, you see, this is probably an automated thing. It's grammatically incorrect here. It says, join Charles's Hangout, and it's got Charles with an apostrophe, then it sticks another S at it. So it's Charles's.
Yeah, that's automated. Charles's.
You think that the Google people would be smart enough to fix that, you know? There's an S at the end of the name, put an apostrophe, don't put another S.
Well, you know, it's Google. I mean, they've got billions of dollars to spare, you know. I don't think they care.
It's like, you know, you have one messages waiting for you.
Messages is.
Yeah, it's rather, but the more modern ones say you have one message. They're smart enough to know than messages. So
I'm waiting for them to figure out what the plural of moose is.
Mooses.
Mises?
No, it's mooses.
Mouses?
It's moose.
But yeah, Google Glass, awesome thing. And here in the next few days, we're going to start to see the video evolve, and I'm going to actually be wearing my glasses. It's going to be so great. I like right now, having my glass over top of my glasses makes it hard to see. You know, taking off my glasses to wear the Google Glass is kind of stupid because I can't really see. You know, but having them together finally, yay!
Well, coming up in hour two, we're going to have our computer and technology news. Got some great stories. Of course, that's going to be brought to you by Slimware Utilities, the official optimization software of Computer America. Also, we have our brand new
London Minute.
Well, a brand new London Minute. No, it's not brand new. It's a new one. We have two London Minutes, one in each hour. But we also have our new segment here that we just started last night. It's called.
Oh yeah.
It's called "I'm Not Paranoid If It's Really Happening," and we're going to have that in the second hour. This is basically. Tips and tricks and things from Charles Tindall.
Not to get hacked and end up on websites like that of our guest.
Change your password. From
Actually, the most secure password right now is 123456.
Or password.
Or password. Yeah, or Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we have a great show planned for you tonight. And, you know, so let's get to it, all right? I mean, we've got lots to talk about, so let's get our guest on.
Let's get her done.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, you know, before... my wife went out with me on a date. You know, she actually had me checked out.
I had you checked out before I took the job.
Oh, wow. But see, in her case, she worked for law firms for like 30 years, so she had the company's private investigator do a search on me, and she had that resource.
Doesn't that make you feel good, though? Like, she met you, she heard about you, she was so interested in you that she stalked you. She stalked you. She knew you were good quality, and you weren't a serial killer or an axe murderer. And she went on that first date with you, and had already planned out the next 20 years of your life.
But what if you don't work for lawyers, or what if you don't have access to that kind of service? And let's face it, not everybody does. But now you do, using your internet connected computer. The company's called Dirt Search. I love that name, Dirt Search. It's a search engine like Google that simply gathers information, patterns, or names from public records and returns results. Now, Dirt Search's mission, according to their website, is to accurately search public records databases and data sources with intuitive, accurate information on parties whose names have been inputted into the search engine.
Ooh, Craig, I found your mugshot.
Their goal is, do I have hair? Their goal is to accurately link all of the online public records and data sources on the internet, searchable from one place. They wish to fulfill the void that our local agencies and municipalities have left by getting this information to the public for easy access. Now, joining us here tonight is Eric Knight. Eric is the founder of DirtSearch.org. Eric, welcome to Computer America. How are you?
Hey, I'm great. Thank you guys for having me tonight.
Yeah, so Dirt Search.
Every time Craig says it, I'm like, oh, man, that's straightforward and to the point. What are we looking for? Dirt.
Dirt, exactly. I mean, how did you come up with the idea with DirtSearch.org? What was the motivation behind it? I mean, did you go out on a date and you wanted to check somebody out, or what was the story?
No, ironically enough, though, family did. So... just like you guys, I'm fairly technical out there in the world, and everybody knew I knew how to find stuff, especially digging deep to find stuff, but it was time-consuming. Mm-hmm. So I was asked over and over and over to be like, hey, I'm going to go out on a date with so-and-so, or so-and-so's dating this person. What do you know? They're getting serious. Mm-hmm. And they said, you know, look it up. So 3 to 4 hours later, I was able to produce a list, and the next day they broke up. So then I had to do it all again next week.
Wow. How did that make you feel? You were responsible for breaking up this loving, budding relationship.
Well, he saved somebody's life.
I won't take responsibility for
that. So you handed it to him in like this plain vanilla envelope and said, "If you can take the red pill or the blue pill.
Open at your own.
All I'm offering you is the truth."
Exactly. But doing it a number of times, I was exhausted, and it just seemed like it was never ending, and I had to ask myself, okay, there's got to be an easier way, and there's got to be something out there.
Well, aren't there things out there that the PIs, private investigators, use, and professional agencies that they can look up and find all kinds of things on anybody that they want to? Aren't there some things like that out there already?
There's a lot of services. A lot of it's manual still. I know as a starting place, a lot of the PIs that have contacted us, and they even on their websites reference DirtSearch.org, but they start there. again, then they dig down into it. But it's a very time-consuming process because everybody's got a doppelganger out there or a twin online, and trying to get down to it and
then you just used the term doppelganger, and I know my wife is listening to this, and she's jumping up and down, and I'm about to get a Vampire Diary text. And I blame you.
And you know what? You know who told me that one would be my wife too, and she's listening.
Oh, see?
That was required language.
Oh no.
Hello, Mrs.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Mrs. Knight, did you check out Eric on Dirt Search?
She cyberstalked him.
Oh, she could. Maybe she wasn't Mrs. Knight at the time.
Well, let's keep going. I mean, Eric, you're telling us that so there's a lot of different sources out there. You know, people go out and troll the deep, deep webs to find out this information about, you know, different things. What makes Dirt Search so what makes it different than like Spokio or any of those other ones?
Troubles me that you
a lot of, are.
Oh, trust me, I can digitally skip trace the life out of everyone. Do you remember when all you told me about was your 007 Lamborghini or Ferrari or whatever it was?
Lotus.
Yeah, you told me about that. You told me three words from that, and 10 minutes later, I presented you with a picture of it on a forum somewhere.
It was mine.
I am a digital ninja.
Go ahead, Eric.
Yeah, unfortunately, not everybody's a digital ninja.
I know.
That's awesome. I like doing it. I enjoy doing it. I enjoy actually looking online and finding the stuff because I was my own, you know, the internet's brought it to where I could be my own private eye. But not everybody enjoys it as much as I did.
Okay. So is this how does the website work? Why don't you just describe it to us?
We try to keep it simple. And when you go to Dirt Search, basically you enter a first name and a last name. And like that same process that I was telling you about, it goes out, and we keep an in-house database as well, but it goes out and it's searching all those other places. And everybody's like, well, Google does that. But Google doesn't. They don't go out and check the things that are not just printed out in the world. And none of these databases are actually printed out in the world. You actually have to go to that site, punch in the information, and comb through to see if you have a match. And every single site is completely different. Every single county, every single state, every single city has some sort of difference to it. And so even if you can't even get a system down as far as doing it by hand and getting kind of like a rhythm to figure it all out.
Well, now I do notice on the homepage it says that it asks for the first name, it asks for the last name, and it also asks for a state or province too. So I guess you're kind of narrowing it down.
Let's see, Craig Crossman. Me?
Not that, you know. So why the state and province?
Well, I mean, we try to narrow it down, but there's such a thing as too narrow it too. I mean, we eventually want to be able to identify individuals in a certain city, and you mentioned Spokio and things like that earlier. They do a really good job of identifying people's mailing address and identifying stuff from mass mailings. They get information from all over the place. We're trying to not limit that information, but yet empower the person using the site to be their own, you know, kind of PI. That stuff that it's going out and getting, it may not pull addresses and things like that, but I think Spokio even is one of the sites that it searches.
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
It creates a list, and it's supposed to be a short list. So you can actually take, instead of something that took 4 or 5 hours to do, you can go through the list in 4 or 5 minutes, maybe a little bit longer, and actually know who you're looking at. But you still got to know information about them to limit it down.
There's one thing I want to clarify here, because I see on the website you say, please help keep Dirt Search free, and there's a $1 donate button that you can do, which is really wonderful. But I need to ask you this up front, because when we post what the topic of who the guest is going to be on many, many areas, Twitter, Facebook, this is what we do, and some of the comments came back says Dirt Search is not free. So I kind of scratched my head, and I said, well, I thought it was. So let me just ask you right out, is it free? And if not, what charges may users incur if they use Dirt Search?
Well, no, it is absolutely 100% free.
I'm sorry, Eric, I didn't want to jump over, but
yeah.
I think I understand why we're getting that, because Dirt Search is, and Eric, correct me if I'm wrong, you're doing API calls to various different search engines around the interweb, and when that information gets brought back to get to some of the more detailed, more in-depth stuff, some of those websites might actually charge, right?
Absolutely. A lot of them do, even state. I mean, in California alone, most of those, that information, to get any real detail, they'll give you a teaser, even the state. But yet they want you to pay for that full record because they're generating revenue off of that. So we want to make sure that we can identify that there's good data there, but we run 100% on, you know, pay-per-click advertising and donations. In fact, for the most part, it doesn't cover the expenses. We rely on volunteers too. So when it comes to technical people, we're always in dire need of technical volunteers.
You'll get an email from me. I'd love to help you.
That'd be great.
I
mean,
I'm running out of hours in a 24-hour period to volunteer, but you know, I can definitely. I mean, I love things like this. And I mean, like the first thing I noticed that was different about Dirt Search is one of the things on here is you've got a dirt alert, get notified when you are searched. That's really cool. You know, you got your iGoogle, and you guys are really simple, really basic, and it's just I'm actually really kind of impressed. I mean, aside from the fact that you found a Facebook profile for me that I'm pretty sure isn't me.
You don't have Facebook. You
I don't. Well, actually, I think I still have like a busted one. Like, I think I still have one that I used, because remember we did the I forget what guest we had who was having trouble getting stuff onto Facebook, and I did that quick and dirty hack for him.
Yeah,
I think I still have that one out there somewhere. But, you know, one of the other things that I'm noticing about DirtSearch.org is it's not like like all those other, you know, record diving into websites where it's you get your information, you know, you do your search, you get your information, and then you're presented with all of these trap links where they all, every last single solitary one of them goes to, oh, yeah, if you want this, pay us $20. You know, if you want this information, pay us $20. And it's just like, that is horrible. And you guys you're linking to things like People and Spokio, and you know, you're staying true to it. So, you know, yeah. I mean, I would definitely love
to
be involved.
And for that, we'll never charge. We don't, you know, there'll never be a pay model. I mean, we really want to bring accuracy, and it gets smarter through time. But I mean, this is free stuff that's out there.
Yeah.
And eventually, if we can get big enough to where we can even buy stuff and make it free, we're trying to start down that path right now, because this is public information. I mean, you shouldn't have to pay for something that, again, is public. It's the definition of public.
I mean, aren't you worried that you're like you know, I'm not one of those people that charge exorbitant fees for me doing an electronic skip trace on someone, but I am one of those people who believe that the time that it used to take, and you know, this is the power of the internet, the time that it used to take to find this information, to get all this stuff down and taken care of, you know, that's worth something. My time is worth something to people, and or at least to me. And you know, it would be, aren't you worried that you're going to catch those people who are just going to specifically come after you because you're giving away the magic secret?
Not really, because again, it's an automated system, and it gets better and it gets better. But at this point, I mean, nobody can replace a true technical person doing what you're doing, mm-hmm. because you can identify things that no algorithm, no matter how smart, maybe, you know, we're talking years and years in the future, could get to, but there's still that human element. I mean, a lot of people go to the site, they do searches, and still sometimes when they use the website, they don't know what they're looking at, and,
right.
and there's value there, and I think there's going to always be value there.
Yeah, okay.
Now, you have a list here on the homepage, again, of some of the sites online that you search real-time, and they include, and it, I have to say, it is amazingly impressive. There is a lot of stuff that this is doing. Of course, it's all automated, you know, and it's nice. One of the things that I like about it, Addison in the chat room actually brought this up, one of the things that I really liked is that you actually give a countdown showing approximately how long it's going to take, and I appreciate any application, software, what have you, that lets me know approximately how long the process is going to take, whether it be a thermometer bar moving across my screen, something. You have a countdown timer, and I think that's really nice.
And it's accurate.
Yeah, and well, that's even better if it's accurate. Exactly. Don't you just hate those? You know, the thermometer goes all the way to the end, and then it's like it does
that. They're in Windows time at that point.
A fraction of a minute, and then it goes into a time stasis, and that last little piece takes like 5 hours. You know, something.
Yeah. I mean, it's in Windows minutes. You know, Windows will tell you an estimated 10 minutes remaining. 2 hours later, Windows is estimating 1 minute remaining.
Or it'll complete it, and it'll say, and then it'll go back again, starting saying round two.
Uh-huh.
You know? It'll do that in round three and round four. No, but you're right. With Dirt Search, it, you're Now, how did you come up with that little feature?
It was actually a requirement. What it comes down to is it takes a lot of time to process this stuff, even for a computer, to sort through it all. Mm-hmm. So we've got states like New York, Texas, and California, and there's over 1,000 sites in each state that we're looking through. And as you go through there, I mean, even sometimes we cap it. We say that, you know, you don't want to wait more than, you know, I think it's like 5 or 6 minutes is the maximum, and it calculates it by the number of sites it's looking at. But it actually still may be working in the background. So if you do a search and run it a half hour later, it may even have more stuff that it found in through the background process.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Wow. Okay, so let's do this. Of course, if you have a question or a comment for our guest, you can give us a call at 347-884-8881, 347-884-8881. I'll get you on and get you through. Email is live, L-I-V-E, at computeramerica.com. Please join us in our live interactive add-on chat room. From our homepage at computeramerica.com, you'll see there's a chat room button. Just click it. Enter in a username. That's the name you'd be known by when you go in there. Click the sign-in button and your Java-enabled browser on a Windows machine, Mac, Linux, they all work. We'll move you into the chat room. Eric Knight is also our guest. He's in there. He's got the green avatar, meaning he's the guest for the hour. You can also Skype us, too, if you like. Our Skype address is Computer America, and that's all one word. So
it's really just Computer America?
Yeah. That's all one word, is not part of it. Exactly. So let's continue on. So you also have developed a mobile application for this. Why?
A lot of people, this fell into a dating realm. So a lot of our users are actively in the dating scene, and I'm sure you guys are aware, 10, 15 years ago, dating online was a huge, you know, no-no. People never really did it, but now it's a prime source of meeting people.
It was scandalous. I mean, you said, what did you mean? Oh, he met online. Oh, you went where? You know, I mean, that's how,
right.
And now it's evolved into, like, you know, it's like everyday thing. But you're right. It started out as a scandalous way of meeting somebody.
So when people were out and about or even meeting somebody at a bar or something like that, they wanted to be able to do a quick, again, quick profile, just kind of, you know, I've got a feeling. I want to check this out. They have a brief view of really what that person's history may be and on the fly. And so you guys know everything's going mobile. So it was just kind of the next logical. As mentioned earlier, we built an API for it that our actually apps use that API as well. So we wanted to make sure that that was out there for everybody to use if we were going to go to all that trouble as far as putting that out there.
Wait a minute. So now I'm at a bar, let's say, and I'm walking up to somebody on that. And she says, oh, hi, how are you? And she takes her mobile phone, takes a picture of me, and says, just a moment, I need to check something here.
She won't have to do that. She'll have Google Glass.
Google Glass.
Right.
She's checking you out as you speak, so all your criminal records come up, all your past, you know, arrest records come up. You know.
Well, you know, I mean, this is also something else. You know, there's, and this is something that I deal with on a regular basis with my clients, is people ask, you know, how can I do that? How can I erase myself from the internet? And my general response is, you can't. You know,
right.
It's just not possible to do it anymore. But you can control what people can find about you.
Didn't you see the last episode of the Batman movie that was on the flash drive that you put it in and it erases all your records? You know?
Oh yeah, I'll sell that to you. I'll sell you that, and I'll also sell you some beachfront property I've got in Michigan.
It was called Clean Slate.
Yeah,
exactly. Okay, so that doesn't exist, huh? Okay.
I mean, it does.
On that note, to be fair, yeah, that's why we came up with Dirt Alert. Is because if people are going to be out there looking information on you, it's a two-way street. We think it's fair that they know that they're being looked up. So if they want to sign up on the website at dirtsearch.org, they can actually go and click, you know, manage interface. They can save searches and actually, like, save an alert. So, and you can do it on other people, too. So I've got my whole family on there. So I actually had somebody look somebody up the other day, and I sent them forwarded them the email, and they're like, they didn't know I could do that. And it gives you an idea of what city they're in, and the number of other people and their names that they looked up in the last hour. So, I mean, information's a two-way street.
Oh, okay. So if you're going to look me up, then I'm going to turn around and say, okay, well, I'm going to look you up.
Exactly.
A tit for tat, exactly.
Well, I mean, it still gets into kind of that, for lack of a better term, isn't it, that creepy, you know, how much do you want to really know about that blind date? Like, you know, it's like... what happens when your employer gets a hold of something like this? You know, I mean, I have clients all the time who it turns into, you know, they did something stupid at a party many, many moons ago, and it's out there on the interwebs, and they're scared. And, you know, places like this, you know, it exposes it. I mean, aren't you worried that there are going to be people out there who are going to be like, oh, God, you know, how do I get rid of this? And that's something else that I applaud you for having. You know, I'm flipping through your website, and I don't see a, you know, pay us, you know, $6,000, $7,000, $8,000, $10,000, and we can help get rid of this, you know, stuff on your website, where it's just really, you know, this is about information, you know, so it's not one of those, you know, I'm going to extort you websites. But, you know, that doesn't that worry you? I mean, you being the creator of all of this, I mean, don't you worry about getting that kind of hate mail or something?
Do you get any death threats for this?
Yes, I absolutely have. And, you know, when it comes to the information that's on there, we're very open to, I mean, we have a no-block policy, because the people that want blocked are the people that you need to know the most about. So if something is broken, they email one of our volunteers, and, you know, somebody looks at it, they checks it, and if it's good, and actually there is data there, nothing happens. But if it's bad data, or the data is no longer there, it gets cleared out and gets removed. I mean, most of the people that interact with us are very pleasant, and they're very happy with it, as long as, you know, the understanding is what's out there is out there. Whether we list it or not, it doesn't change the fact that it's out there.
Well, you're telling me you're not the hosting company. You are just the engine to find these things.
Yeah, the music is that, right. We have to take a break. This is the Computer America Show on Blog Talk Radio and the Boost Radio Network and the IRN Radio Network. We've got lots more coming up. This is the Computer America Show. Joe Starch is with us. Stay with us.
Hey, everyone. Have you heard about the no-no hair removal device that's sweeping the globe? If you want to go weeks without shaving and get smooth, professional, quality results, here's our favorite host, Cheryl, for no-no hair removal.
Thanks. Hey, gals. I love talking about my no-no. It's this cute little hair removal system that you can take with you and use almost anywhere, at home or on the road. No more expensive in-office treatments, painful waxing, and no more wasting your valuable time. Got unwanted facial hair? No-No has patented Thermacon technology that works on all hair and skin colors, so it's perfect for using on all body parts. And now you can take advantage of this incredible risk-free trial. Get the No-No, the facial kit, a travel case, and a $100 discount shopping card, and you don't risk a penny to try it. Try the incredible No-No hair completely risk-free. Call 1-800-953-5415. That's 800-953-5415. 800-953-5415.
Looking for a best friend? Brother Wolf Animal Rescue has your best friend waiting just for you. Their mission is to protect and enhance the lives of companion animals and the people who love them. Their no-kill rescue shelter is open year-round, making it easy for people to adopt their best new friend. This year, Brother Wolf will find homes for over 2,400 orphan dogs, puppies, cats, and kittens. All have ended up as an orphan through no fault of their own. Brother Wolf has created a safe, nurturing environment where these special animals can heal emotionally and physically until they find a lifelong home. Their life-saving transport program brings dogs and puppies from overcrowded shelters in the south to rescues in the north where homes are easier to find. Brother Wolf Animal Rescue is a 501c3 organization. To learn more about their life-saving work and to make a donation, visit their website at www.bwar.org. That's www.bwar.org. Help to realize Brother Wolf's vision when no animal is euthanized for lack of a home.
What a good boy.
This is your London Minute, brought to you by UpDesk, the creators of ergonomic, height-adjustable, stand-up desks. Go to updesk.com to raise your standards. Are you a digital native? Take my quiz. 1. You use your smartphone's self-facing camera like a handy pocket mirror. 2. You can return the Apple earpods back into their case neatly under 15 seconds, the way the Apple product designer Kurt Steele intended. 3. You fondly remember what WIMP stands for. 4. You're comfortable with blue screens of death. 5. Your phone's full of selfies. 6. You like mashups like FaceTube and Interweb. 7. You confidently weave hashtags into everyday conversation. 8. You know your pop, from your IMAP. 9. You check your smartphone is in your pocket at least 8 times a day.
That's me.
And finally, 10. Your heart skips a beat when it's missing. If you said yes to at least 7 out of 10, congratulations, you're a digital native. Tweet me your number to @ComputerTweety. This is Patricia Reichel for Computer America.
I think there should be an 11.
What is that?
If you wear Google Glass.
Well, yeah, she made you a digital native.
I know, but you know, I think there should totally be I think it should be a part of the thing. I'm a default digital native.
Yes, you're a default because you wear a Google Glass. I think that boosts you right to the top. All the other ones don't matter. If you're wearing Google Glass, you're a digital native.
There you go.
All right.
What?
Eric Knight, he is the founder of DirtSearch.org, and we're interviewing him. And I have another question for you, Eric. What do you find interesting about the data you collected? Is there anything that kind of leaps out at you?
The type of people that are using DirtSearch. Again, we thought it would be more of a technical tool, but it's actually mostly young women that are using the tool.
Yeah, really?
That makes total sense.
I'm not surprised at all. No, I would think that makes perfect sense. I think they have more to lose. I just think that being well equipped or not knowing about somebody that you're going out with a total stranger for the first time, it's nice to know that find out that they were acquitted from axe murdering somebody or something like that.
I don't know if I would want to even go out with somebody who was accused of being an axe murderer, because that would put an end to a date really, really fast.
Would they find something like that on Dirt Search if someone was against them?
They'll find felony convictions. They'll find prison time. I mean, some sites even like mugshots will come up. I mean, it just depends on what the locality of where they're looking is willing to share with us, and that's constantly growing. And we're trying to reach out to them and help them share more with us. But yeah, a lot of that stuff comes up, and I've heard a number of stories where somebody's going to do a business deal. And they did a search, and they realized that somebody was in some kind of civil suit, and they were suing over another business deal, and it was a huge red flag.
Right. Well, my thing is that my warning is that if I go to the post office, I see the picture up on the wall. That's an indicator right there. I don't want to go out with them.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Your wife still went out with you after all your weird things that she found about you, right?
But she, actually, when she did that, they found nothing. That was the interesting thing.
I think
a parking ticket. You know, no, I didn't have anything.
I think I would be a little more scared.
Yeah,
about someone that has nothing.
Yeah, I had nothing. That was it. So I had a car accident when I was 18 or something like that, and that came up, but that was about it. You know, just nothing bad on it. And so I just figured, okay, yeah, I could probably go out with this guy, and look what happened.
Yeah, she ended up marrying you, and it was all downhill from there.
Eric, how can we protect our identity online?
That's actually a big part, and we talk about that a lot. And the number one search on Dirt Search is yourself. So the first thing that everybody does when they go to the page is they look themselves up. And I think that's important because you guys were talking about employers earlier. Employers, they're looking you guys up.
That was exactly what I did. First thing I did.
And what's happening is you know, there's a lot of legalities around it. You can't do a background check without getting permission, things like that, for an employer. But what they're doing is they've got systems integrated into their resume scanning and things like that. And if you come across their desk, and these are big employers I know that are using the site, you may not even get that interview, let alone to the next step to get to a background check if something comes up, because they're using it as a quick read through when they're getting 10,000 resumes, and you might have something fuzzy on yours. Well, they're just going to pass. They're not going to waste the time to dig into it. So it's important that somebody goes online and Dirt Search and any of the sites and know what's out there on them and be able to set themselves away and apart from those profiles that may not be theirs.
Well, how private? Let me ask you this: how private are my searches on Dirt Search? I mean, can you go in there and say,
oh, look, Charles did a search on Craig, you know, and then you can you go and see who did what on Dirt Search, or is that confidential? Is that private? I mean, how?
It's pretty private. I mean, you guys were talking about in the chat room about being able to see, you know, an IP address, things like that. That stuff is in there, but unless you can associate that to a particular identity, which 9 times out of 10 we can't, it's just relative, and it's for use for the Dirt Alert system. So that's how it basically says, okay, you looked somebody up, and it associates those other people with your searches. Other than that, there's really no, like, you don't stand out. There's no, you know, no tracking going on, no NSA.
Well, you see, because, like, for example, when someone does a credit check on you, you go and you can see all the people who did credit checks on you. I mean, that's what. So, but with Dirt Search, you can't go on and say, well, let me see if anybody ran a search on me on Dirt Search. There's no way that it doesn't report that.
At this time, there's not, but the tools are, you know, what we want eventually is to have a great interface to where it'll grow to where you can actually go through and tag and make comments and kind of say, hey, this is me, hey, this is not me, to kind of help complete that data and give a more accurate individual record. But as of today, there's nothing like that.
And that isn't that, would that be a good thing, or is that something you want to implement? I mean, or do you want to implement something like that?
We want to get the best data for the end user, so without crossing that line, because that's why we keep the site basic, and it's very basic looking and very broad, is because we want to empower people but not limit it down and put them in a box to where they're not getting good data, or we're making the decision to exclude data. We don't want that. We really want, unless the system can truly identify differences between profiles and people, we don't want to make that decision for the end user.
Well, how do you, when you say I don't want to cross that line, first of all, how do you know where that line is? I mean, that little sucker keeps moving. How do you know, how do you base that? I mean, how do you know you've crossed the line?
The line for us right now is if we're in there manipulating any of the data. So if we say this is relevant and this isn't, we've crossed that line.
Okay.
Okay.
You're not making any judgment values. You're just presenting all the data as much as you can find, and then let the person looking at it make that decision.
No, they judge you.
Right.
They judge just you.
I know, and I hate that when they do that.
Yeah, well, yeah, things happen.
Mm-hmm. Eric, so that's basically it. Well, let me ask you this: what is creating Dirt Search, you know, taught you about, you know, online access to this information, if anything?
Well, it's taught me that, I mean, I look at companies like Zillow and things like that that actually have taken a mass amount of mismatched data and organized it into something meaningful. And I'm hoping that as we progress and as it grows, that we become more in line with that. But the actual data and the way it's constructed and the way the cities operate differently from the counties that they're in, from the states that they're in, there is no constant between any of them. So, and the rules are different, the laws are different. So trying to bring some value to the end user has been extremely difficult and continues to be a battle. I mean, we spend a lot of time on the phone calling these places saying, hey, how can we help you get this stuff online? The only request we have is let us show it.
Okay. Okay.
And it's difficult. It's truly difficult because, I mean, a lot of these smaller cities and counties don't even understand what that means.
It is kind of weird because, you know, it's you know, six in one hand, half dozen in the other. You got the people want to have it out there for one reason or another, but then, you know, it's how do you make it into something manageable, you know? And yeah.
Well, you know, it's a double-edged sword. If you want to find data on anybody, that means those people can find data on you too, you know. So where do you draw? I mean, if you accept that premise, then you leave yourself open for the same scrutiny. To the same scrutiny.
Everybody wants access to it. Everyone wants that special access to secret information, but nobody wants it on them.
That's right.
There's a lot of things they can do. Right. There's a lot of things that they can do that are common sense things to avoid showing up in those searches. So we talk about all the credit card fraud and everything that's going on. We say do something simple. Have a PO box that's not in your zip code. Send all your data to there. Send all your credit card stuff to there. So if somebody does, and they are able to build an online profile about you, that's one of the missing pieces. I mean, unfortunately, Dirt Search could be used for bad. If somebody has physical access to you and then they build an online profile on you, you could probably put together enough information by looking up your house. At that point, they've got your 5-digit zip code for all your credit cards. I mean, There's a lot of that.
You can't beat yourself up over that. Look, as you say, it's a tool, and you can take virtually anything and use it for bad. I mean, a screwdriver is for, you know, tightening screws, but with the wrong hands, it could be used as like an ice pick and hack somebody, you know.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what it is. As you say, it's just a tool. It's how it's being used. I don't think I can think of anything that could not be fall into that category, good and bad.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah. Well,
exactly. Where do you see Dirt Search in the next couple of years? What do you want to do with this? You want to expand it? What do you want to do with it?
Like our motto says and our mission is we want accuracy. If we can refine accuracy, and you guys are really into the whole skip tracing and things like that, you know one link or one information will give you a date of birth. The next one will give you a middle name. The next place will give you first and last name. The next place may give you an approximate age. Together, that information's worthless if you can't tie it all together. So our algorithm will get smarter, and our work will, you know, come together a little bit better, and we can create and be able to identify John Smith 1 versus John Smith 2, and that's where we really want to go.
Yeah.
You remember the last hacker show we had? We had a gentleman called the Intern.
Yes, so, the Intern.
I wonder, do you think Intern uses Dirt Search, or does he even know about it, Charles?
I don't know, but I think he will now. I mean, I've seen some of the things that he does. He does, and you know, Eric, you're right. He takes that little bit of information, you know, the tiniest microscopic little leads. Like I've seen the man end up on a Facebook page, and from the name on a napkin in the background of a photo, be able to take that and add it to his search and his development criteria. And that is just phenomenally and amazing. And a tool like Dirt Search might actually help him get through that faster. So,
well, you're saying Dirt Search is now being used by professionals?
Absolutely. I mean, we have been contacted, and we're not going to name names or anything, but we've been contacted by IT departments of large companies that are using it professionally that are saying, hey, we need access to your site. What do we need to unblock to make sure that this department can have access to your site?
Really? How does that make you feel?
It's a little concerning, as you know, we've all had jobs, so it's definitely, you know, I'm an employer as well, so I get both sides, but it's, when we talk about that line, they're truly, truly pushing that fine line.
Yep. I mean, there was this big uproar not too long ago about quite honestly the access that your employer has to your information. You know, it was just, it's just like, what's going on here, guys? You know, should there be a line drawn for the HR department to be able to Facebook stalk me? You know, it's just really a matter of you know, where somebody's ethics go. And you know, I mean, honestly, like I said, there are things there are just things that happen, you know, that happen to good people way back when that really just needs, you know, just it's just out there, and in the wrong context, it's going to be taken the wrong way.
For a while, I know a number of employers were even, and I don't even know what the legality of this is, asking users in an interview to log them into their Facebook to take a look.
Yeah. And I'm like, you can't do that. Like, no.
Eric, you said you're an employer. So, I mean,
that's correct, yep.
Be forthcoming. Do you use Dirt Search, and has it revealed things that you maybe didn't want to know, or you were happy to find out? I mean, personally.
Oh wow, that is a very a tough question. Yes, has it altered our decision any way from hiring or not hiring somebody? No, but it did give us an inkling as far as, you know, hey, what kind of position this person may be good for, or what, you know, what they can or can't do because of legal history or things like that. So you definitely, especially when you're looking at like the partner level of a business, things like that, you don't want to take on a business partner that has, you know, tax issues or outstanding judgments. So, you know, in those cases, absolutely, it's altered our decisions. But as far as hiring just a general employee, like I said, that comes down to, in my view, as being illegal. So we do not use it in those cases, and has not altered any of our decisions on that front.
Okay, well, if we get into the legality of this, is it illegal to use services like Dirt Search in helping you to form an opinion of whether you're going to hire somebody or not?
I think that's, the law has not caught up with technology yet. It's not just that. I mean, if you look at the you know, the Housing Act in America. Mm-hmm. I know before people are renting people properties, they're running, you know, instead of spending the $100 or whatever it may be on a full background check, they're running them through Dirt Search. And, you know, how does that fall in the Fair Housing Act? We're not really sure.
You mean, oh, so if you find out information about a potential tenant coming in that wants to rent your home or, you know, your space, whatever it might be, and they have a record that said, you know, the last two places they were at, they totally trashed, chances
right.
are, I'm not gonna let them rent the space. I mean, can you find information like that on Dirt Search, or is that?
Absolutely. In fact, one of the most common lawsuits out there are apartment complexes, because they almost always sue tenants that leave in bad terms.
Oh.
And that's going to pop up on a civil suit. And again, that's a gray area, because you technically, to do a background check, you have to have a tenant sign off on it. And
mm-hmm.
it's a really gray area.
Really?
Well, I mean, that's the other thing, is they can get away with it because it becomes public information. So, you know,
right.
what's to stop them from pulling up, you know, that mugshot from one other place? You know, it's such a touchy area that it's just like, really, you know, what are we going to do here?
So this is a perfect example of where our legislation hasn't really caught up to the technology.
Absolutely.
Hmm.
And it's starting to. If you guys are familiar with the whole mugshot ordeal, and I think somebody was talking about that in chat,
mm-hmm.
A lot of the, you know, Google shut them down with their SEO algorithms and things like that. That's part of their upgrade that happened in August.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of on the, even though, you know, it's a gray area, I'm kind of on Google's side on that, because they're putting pictures up of people that are, you know, don't have convictions. I mean, the stuff that we're searching specifically is stuff, for the most part, public records. Something did get filed. It doesn't go away. Your mugshot gets deleted out of their system after, you know, so long, especially if there's no conviction, but yet these other companies are archiving them forever.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, and they can do that, you know, but I mean,
they have the right to do that, yeah, right.
And it's a multi-million dollar business. It's just like, wow, really? You know, I don't know. I honestly, part of me is like, this is public information, but the other part of me is like, this is information that you know, there should be a little more work to get a hold of.
Right. Mm-hmm. It's going to be easier and easier, and that's what it's come down to. And what we're seeing is they're making it more and more available, and they're incentivized to do it, especially as the states and, again, all the municipalities, things like that, can actually make this as a revenue source. And a lot of them, like where we're at in Arizona, they're willing to sell you the entire database dump for anywhere from $3,000 to $10,000, and it's yours. And they dump everything.
Yeah, I mean, I see the different things that are happening with people, the different stuff, the different ideas that people have about this, and, you know, that type of cyber extortion for stuff like that. I mean, you want to get access to the database, that's great, but, you know, there's still people out there that are like, you know, I happen to be in whatever database for whatever reason or however much, and then there are sites like Dirt Search where it's we're just giving you an engine to get to information that's out there. But then again, there are the other ones that are out there are like, oh no, we're not going to tell you jack. We're not going to give you any context whatsoever. You've got a mugshot that specifically says you were convicted of, you know, vehicular assault or something crazy somewhere. You know, or you were involved in some sort of bust, and then it's, oh, by the way, we can have it removed for $10,000. You know, but Google, you know, it's good to hear that Google finally said, you know what, we're not going to SEO you guys. We know you're just out here to scam people. You know, so
that was all a scam. Anybody who claimed they could remove something from the internet or your record really couldn't do it.
Well, they were willing to delete it from their site and maybe a couple parody sites, but you guys know. Basically, once it's out there, you can't get anything off. I mean, it gets archived forever.
Well, I remember this was years ago where I invited a company, someone to come on the program, and they had a service where they said that, you know, that they could remove any bad information about you from the internet. And I was skeptical, but I brought them on anyway.
There's no such thing as remove. Like, you can never remove yourself from the interwebs, like, that just doesn't happen. And anybody who's going to tell you that are just straight lying to you.
Well, basically, that's the recall. That's,
and I think a number of those companies got sued over that claim.
If I remember correctly.
So now they've really changed it to what they do is they bury. So they put so much good stuff up. They tell you, you know, do these things.
Mm-hmm.
Have a positive LinkedIn profile. Have a positive Facebook page. Have your own website. Have a blog. And the idea is the way Google searches, it looks for the newest data first, and it just buries it. So it doesn't go anywhere, but it may be on page 2 or 3, but it doesn't go away. It's still out there, and people that are skilled to find this thing, this type of stuff, they're still going to find it regardless.
This is Happy Charles now. We have everywhere here. Angry Charles, you can't find him. He's on the 50th page, right?
No, you can. I mean, there is angry stuff out there about Charles. You just got to know how to find it. But the other thing is Charles is his digital ninja. You know, if you are patient enough to make it to page 50 of a search results for Charles Tendell, more power to you.
Yeah, exactly. And that picture of him up in the post office wall doesn't count.
Oh no, that one's the one I want you to see. That's the one that was taken right after I got out of the Army. My hair was really long, and I gave that angry, like, "Why are you talking to me?" look.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh. Listen, Erica, this has been a lot of fun and extremely informative. People go, again, the website is dirtsearch.org, not .com, it's dirtsearch.org, O-R-G. You want to make sure that you get that correct. And we also have it listed on our website at computeramerica.com. Just go to our show notes page, and you'll see today's date. It's January the 30th, and you'll see dirtsearch.org. It's a hyperlink. You can click on it, and you can see it and try it for yourself. What is your suggestion? What do you think? How do you think people should start? What should they search for?
They should probably do themselves, so they can kind of know a baseline of what to expect out there when they see stuff on other people. So you start with yourself. You go there into your first name and your last name and your state, and find that baseline, because you know what's out there about you.
Mm-hmm.
So it gives you an idea of what you're going to find about somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why most people at Dirt Search, you know, end up doing their first, you know, themselves first.
Okay. And again, it's completely free. It's just you can make a donation to I know you had that $1. Hey, you just have $1 donate. Can you donate more than the $1, or is that all you can do?
Of course you can always donate more, but I mean, we'd be happy with a dollar.
You can always give us more money. We will never turn that down.
Yeah. Okay. Again, as I said, check it out. It's dirtsearch.org, and you can see all the different services that the system checks out, and it's quite extensive. I mean, it's page after page after page. I have a rapid scroll on here, and it takes it several moments for it to get
was
there.
Was it on yourself?
No, I don't know. I'm just looking at the things that Dirt Search checks through to find.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you got the Hawaii County Real Property Tax Office, the Lee County Arrest Warrants, Sunflower County Circuit Court Criminal, Salt Lake County, Most Wanted. I mean, they've got all these different titles here. Why are some of them in big letters and some of them in small letters?
It's just the algorithm, and some of them, as far as the number of much, it's organized as far as the amount of traffic that comes out of them, and you know how popular they are, and you know how quick they are. So it's kind of like an algorithm that places it all together.
So basically, the larger the font, the more use it gets.
The more use it gets, yeah.
Okay. Like here. Here's the one. This one's the McDonald's record. McDonald's restaurant on South Avenue. That's really small, so there's probably not much out there. But the Northwest Territory Cemetery record. You check cemeteries?
We do. I mean, people use this for genealogy as well. So, I mean, we want birth records, death records. I mean, anything related, you know, dead or alive, we're after it.
Things you wouldn't even consider looking at. Yeah, Emmett County death records. Wow. Shelby County. Just check it out. Go to dirtsearch.org. If nothing more, that'll be extremely enlightening and for you to take it out. By the way, you don't have to register to use Dirt Search, but if you do, you can manage your profile and save searches, some additional things, just by registering at Dirt Search, correct?
That's correct, and that's free. There's no charge for anything. So
right.
You said earlier that some people had mentioned that there's charges. We don't charge for anything. So be sure where you're clicking and what you're looking up, because our site, you know, shows you where the information is, and we do not charge a thing.
And it's not only people. You can also dirt search businesses.
And then we've also recently added a phone number lookup.
Yeah.
A lot of phone number lookups online, and this is how it's different, because, again, we want to give paid things away for free.
Uh-huh.
If you go to normal phone number lookups and you enter a phone number, it'll tell you what phone company that number was assigned to.
Yeah.
And in the world of telecom, almost everybody's moved their phone number once, so it doesn't actually give you the idea.
Yeah.
This site will actually pull the record as of the last 30 days and tell you what telephone company they're with right now.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Wait, who was that again?
Phone lookup.
That's if you click on the phone lookup. It's a beta next to it on the actual page.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it'll pull the record as of right now. And we do pay for those lookups and things like that, so we do limit the number of searches that that you can do per day on that.
Yeah.
But if somebody's looking, you want to know where they're at, where their phone's out of, and what provider they're through right now, it's a great tool.
Yeah.
I'm on there right now.
Yeah, he copied us, because our site is in beta. We have that beta.
In beta. So, wait, Eric, now, so I'm back on Dirt Search.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
A phone lookup. Oh, this is going to be fun.
Yeah, we got to play with this. And the Dirt Bit Search businesses. Listen, we got to go. Eric, I want to thank you so much for being with us here on tonight.
Oh, it's telling me my phone number limit has been reached.
So it's probably just because of the amount of searches you've done today, but it'll clear in 24 hours. And I think you get 10 or 15 searches a day through there.
But is that?
And
but I haven't done any phone searches.
Well, that's why it says beta next to it. So I know that they're working on splitting that off to where right now it's just counting the number of searches you do a day, and eventually that's going to be split off so it's just phone searches for that limit.
Okay.
Eric, thanks so much for being with us here on the show tonight. Very, very enlightening.
Thank you both.
And best of luck with you and continue on with the Dirt Search. You're doing a terrific job. Thanks. Okay. Thanks again.
Thank you, guys.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Night.
Night. All right, guys. Coming up in hour two, we're going to have computer and technology news brought to you by Slimware Utilities. We've got our new segment that's called I'm Not Paranoid If It's Really Happening. We've got that coming up. We've got a new London Minute from Patricia Reichel. We've got lots of great things coming up in hour two of the Computer America Show. We'll be right back in just a few moments. Don't go anywhere.
Broadcasting live, it's the only national radio talk show on computers to air every weeknight, Computer America, hosted by national columnist Craig Crossman. The first hour's behind us, but there's still more of tech news, tech talk, and your phone calls. We're being beamed nationwide at computeramerica.com. You got computer problems? Bring them on. You're listening to Computer America. Computers run the world, and we run computers. Call us or send us an email to live@computeramerica.com.
Hello and welcome into hour two of the nation's longest running, nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers. This is the Computer America Show, and I'm your host,
Craig Crossman.
I'm never going to be able to top that. I am your co-host, certified ethical hacker and digital ninja, Charles Tendell.
There you go. And we just had Dirt Search on in the first hour, Eric Knight. The founder of DirtSearch.org. If you missed it, certainly you can listen to it again. We archive all of our shows at blogtalkradio.com. You can listen to it there. Of course, you can listen to the Computer America Show on the Boost Radio Network. And
The Boost,
yes, exactly. And, of course, as of yesterday, actually, you can hear us live now on the IRN Radio Network. The link is up, so you can actually click on it. You couldn't click on it last night, so do it again, because now you can click on it, and you can see us. They have everything there, and you can listen to the show there as well. Now, the archives are currently only on Blog Talk Radio, so if you want to hear archives of the show, Blog Talk Radio has it, or you can head over to Apple's iTunes. The keyword is Computer America, and subscribe to the Blog Talk Radio podcast. Remember, there's two of them. There's the old one and the new one. The new one is the Blog Talk Radio one. Subscribe to that podcast. And you'll get all of our shows downloaded to you automatically. You can control all of that.
Wow, this is pretty smart.
What is?
So I'm testing out the phone thing.
What phone?
The phone search on Dirt Search.
Oh, yeah. And? Oh.
Now, I know it was telling me a minute ago that I was doing too many searches, but, I'm a digital ninja, so I found a way around that.
Uh-huh.
It is correct based on my carrier.
Well,
it is pretty cool.
Does it find cell phone numbers or just
You have to know the cell phone number.
Yeah.
And then it'll just tell you what carrier they're on.
Oh, okay.
And so then if you have some general information and you're pretty good at social engineering,
yeah,
you can pretty much talk your way through just about anything at that point.
Wow. Okay. I mean,
you could probably be like, oh, well, let's check this out. We're gonna have, you know, I've got your phone number, I've got who I believe you to be. Mm-hmm. You know, so let's call up your provider. I mean, that's kind of how some of these latest hacks have happened, actually.
All right. Well, we have our computer news. We've got lots to talk about. But I think we should do our new segment here. What do you think?
Sure.
Okay. Well, we'll start off with that. If you think your credit cards have been hacked, if you think your bank accounts have been accessed, and it's not you, or if you think that your identity may have been stolen, then this Computer America segment is for you. That's right. It's time for the I'm Not Paranoid If It's Really Happening segment with certified ethical hacker Charles Tendell.
You're going to love the flair for the dramatic that he's got. That's the coolest intro I've ever had to anything I've ever done. Like, I feel like there should have been lights and things flickering on it. Yeah, like a spotlight. Me walking in with my hat and my pipe being like, hello. Of all the offices in all the world, she had to walk into mine.
Uh-huh.
So, like you said, if you feel that your identity has been stolen, your credit card may have been hacked, you think that you got things that have just gone wrong for you for one reason or another, or you're being cyberstalked, this segment is for you. And what we're going to do this one is, everybody's familiar about the Target hacks, I think we've kicked that dead horse once or twice already.
Neiman markup hacks, yeah.
Neiman markup hacks. But there are a couple of other things that you need to be wary of. Mm-hmm. With your machines, and this one is not so much it's an offshoot, and it's happened here. It's happened in Colorado. It's happened in North Carolina. It's happened all over the world, and it came up a while ago. And this one is a physical security tip for you. Now, what happened with all these Neiman Marcus cards and all these Target cards and all these other place cards is they got what was known as skimmed. But this kind was happened electronically, and it happened with malware installed on the devices. Now, you as a consumer can't see that. Mm-hmm. So there's no way for you to know that they were compromised. But credit card skimmers, this latest technology, is just an offshoot of what was once upon a time the old version, which was a physical card skimmer that was physically attached to the card reader. The ATM, the gas pump, the tollway, wherever you might use your card, thieves and criminals had figured out a way to take these little readers and put them up on the thing. And you wouldn't even know it. You'd stick your card in it, and the guy sitting in the bushes a few meters away, he's picking up your card information because it's wirelessly sending it or electronically storing it right then and there. So what can you do as a consumer? Look carefully. Just look a little bit more. You know, at the devices, the gas pump, you know, look around where you put your card at. If the thing seems a little loose, if it seems like there's some weird tape or weird glue or something like that that's on there, if it just looks a little strange, stop what you're doing.
Uh-huh.
Push the button next to it that says call the attendant, or walk in or walk to wherever it is and check the attendant. Before you put your card in it,
yeah,
have them come out and check it for you. And, you know, it's only paranoid. You're only paranoid if it isn't happening to you. You know, just take a look, take an extra 5 seconds, check the hardware, make sure nothing's loose, make sure there isn't any tape anywhere, and you should be a little safer.
I have a question, though. What if you go into the teller and have them come out because this looks a little suspicious? But the teller is in on it, and he said, "No, sir, it's fine."
Ooh, the teller is in on it, and you get that weird, you know, spidey sense tingling feeling. You know, leave. And you know what? You can actually now, because this has become such a big deal, you can get a hold of your local law enforcement. Just dial 911, tell them it's a non-emergency. You need to speak to someone in their fraud department, and you know, somebody with a badge and a glasses and probably an attitude, but hopefully helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Will come to your rescue, and you can explain to them, look, I think there's a credit card skimming thing going on. I noticed these things. But you have to make sure that you know what's going on. If you really want to get in on it, you know, or you really want to see if you can catch these guys, take a couple of pictures of them. You know, and if you're listening to the show and you might find something that's out there that's doing it, you know, send it into the Computer America show, and I'll talk about it on the air. I'll look at your picture and say, actually, this one looks pretty good, but this is a good example of what it should look like or what it shouldn't. Or you should definitely dial 911 and tell someone.
There you go. All right.
Or, like Fort says in the chat room, call the non-emergency number that most law enforcement officers have.
All right. There you go. Well, again, I think that that's a great tip, and I think that if you see something suspicious, you should report it, absolutely. Just don't leave it alone and say, oh, somebody else will take care of
it. Do you know where some of the most interesting places for you to get your identity stolen or to get like your card skimmed from?
Gas stations.
Well, major travel hubs.
Oh.
Because you get people who are passing through. They're going to be getting on a plane. They're going to be getting on a bus. They're going to be getting on a train. They're not going to notice that something's going on for at least a couple of days.
Airports.
Oh. You got to be careful.
Don't they have security, though, that goes and checks airports and stuff like that?
They have security that checks the airport itself, but they don't have so much security that checks the surrounding area of the airport.
I was at an airport not too long ago. They have some of the most amazing machines now, vending machines that do some of the, you can go up there and buy,
anything you can buy from Best Buy.
Yeah, an iPod, ear headsets. I mean, they have everything now in vending machines. It's just gets to be incredible. Have you seen the latest ATMs?
No.
Because all now basically read checks. You don't have those envelopes anymore. I remember when this came out, those were great. But now they have ATMs that give you exact change. I mean, exact. You want to take a $22, and it doesn't have to be divisible by 20s anymore. You can get the exact amount of money you want.
Hmm.
Nice. Yeah, exactly. All right. Let's do some computer news because we got lots of things to talk about.
We sure can.
All right. Tonight's computer and technology news is brought to you by Slimware Utilities, the official optimization software of Computer America. You can visit them at slimwareutilities.com to clean, speed up, and optimize your Windows system for free. And I mean that, absolutely free. No freemium, nothing. You get it, you use it, it's wonderful. Get them all, you'll be happy you did, and you'll thank us for it. All right, so the first story of the evening is Bitcoin.
Hey.
News again. Guess what you can do? We heard about Bitcoin being available at casinos in Las Vegas. That was a news story. Bitcoins, you could use them at Amazon. Bitcoins, you could use them. Well, guess who's now taking Bitcoins? I will not name the organization, but their initials are IRS.
Oh, the irritating revenue service.
You can now pay the IRS in cryptocurrency, according to the story in Forbes, right? The government now is all worried about this because they can't control it, but guess what? They're going to take it.
Well, I mean, this is you got to read on a little bit. I mean, it's really they're teaming up with people to do the transition.
Okay. Well, yeah. It says Bitcoin moves away from being known only to the tech people and become a real viable currency that is adopted broadly, more organizations arise that look to leverage all this attention and add something of value to Bitcoin holders. Snapcard is a San Mateo-based startup with the stated aim of making it possible to buy anything on the Internet using virtual currency. The product works by way of a browser bookmarklet that integrates a Bitcoin checkout process with e-commerce sites. Want to use Bitcoin to pay Zappos for shoes, Amazon for a book, or eBay for some retro stuff? Look at how they make eBay is only retro stuff. Snapcard.
eBay is old and useless now.
No, eBay is not.
Really?
No, they got all some great stuff.
No, eBay is the flea market of the internet now. Now, I give it to you. I've bought some things for cars on eBay, but I have never gone on eBay and been like, oh, I want a brand new object. This is where I'm going to go to get it. Because, I've had a couple of bad experiences on there,
Yeah.
But, like when you go out and you're looking for parts for something, or you're looking for something that's relatively old or something that you're just not going to find on Amazon or Overstock or any of these other places, oh, by the way, Overstock.com takes Bitcoin naturally. Yeah. It's that's where you go, is eBay. But it's like antique shopping on the internet.
Well, the clever thing about this is that the company themselves, like Zappos, might not accept Bitcoin, but this company is stepping in as like a clearinghouse.
Yeah.
So you
a middleman.
A middleman. So you can go to them, and then you can use your Bitcoin for anything that you want.
Now, the idea of paying for e-commerce goods via cryptocurrency isn't a really super novel. It's an obvious use case. Online shopping, online alternative currency, it goes together like, you know, soup and sandwich, love and marriage, horse and carriage. But
peanut butter and jelly? Or no, wait, what is it? I'm trying to remember how the rest of that goes, but I know it goes, you know.
Like, yeah. But whatever, so what if someone told you that they enabled the payment of tax debt via Bitcoin? Now, that's pretty unique, according to the author here, and I agree with him. The last bastion of hyper-cautious government agencies meets the very bleeding edge of economics, especially ironic given the fact that Bitcoin is seen by many as primarily a vehicle for transacting in illegal or non-declared income-generating activities. The idea of paying tax via Bitcoin is sure to have a few people chuckling and more than a few horrified. According to Snapcard founder, Snapcard will extend the program to allow Bitcoin-fueled payment universally. In doing so, Bitcoin will become a replacement for the bill-paying services offered by traditional banks. In terms of how it works, Snapcard uses Coinbase and BitPay to convert Bitcoins into U.S. dollars that are then paid to the payment processor and thereafter to the recipient. Of course, it's not perfect. Well, what is? What happens with an incorrect payment amount? Or when there is a warranty issue with a physical or virtual good, what happens then? Having multiple layers of third parties involved in a payment doesn't make that stuff any easier, right? In terms of the IRS payments, Snapcard charges a $10 flat fee in addition to any IRS payment fees, okay? Snapcard is a young startup. It only has processed $300,000 worth of transactions from a couple of thousand users over its short life. The jury is out whether end users will be comfortable using such a small provider to make payments with several levels of abstraction. In terms of the business they've done so far, the top websites that they see the most purchases from are, not surprisingly, Amazon and eBay.
And I'm on their website now because I have Amazon purchases that I need to make.
Small fry thus far, but as an example of an emerging industry and disruption to traditional payments, it's a telling development. The columnist says, as I wrote this story, I received an email from yet another Bitcoin service, this time Varum, which is a platform for financial institutions to trade, store, and offer Bitcoin to their customers. So there it is, you know. Bitcoin is with something like this, Bitcoin is just becoming more and more accessible to everybody. I think it's really good.
And the more it gets out there,
yeah,
the better. You know, it is truly one of those things that I would we need more Bitcoin. It just needs to happen so that it becomes an international global currency. We can transact using our mobile devices. It'll be fast, it'll be secure, it'll be easy. We can get rid of like dollars and such, you know, and just one unified economy. It'd be great.
You really feel that way about eBay?
I think, honestly, back in the day, I mean, like many, 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 many years ago when I was a young private in the Army, mm-hmm. I capitalized on the eBay boom. Mm-hmm. I really did. Like I ran an eBay store, and I was making money hand over fist doing the eBay dropship thing.
Yeah.
You know, I would order, but the difference, what made me so much better than all the other ones that were doing the same thing, is they'd take the stock photo of the object.
Yeah.
People don't like that. People see the stock photo and they're like, is that an accurate representation? Da, da, da. I would actually purchase one of my products and take pictures.
Yeah. I mean, I remember there were these stores, though, for eBay that you could go and they would do all that for you. You just bring your stuff in and they would
Sell it on eBay stores.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Those are still around. They're still out there, you know. But, you know, honestly, I think eBay is really where is right now. It's a secondhand store. It's where people go and they sell old hardware. They go and they sell, you know, different types of data. They sell different types of things. But you won't, like, when you, like I went on there at one point because I had the idea of buying a new MacBook Pro.
Mm-hmm.
And like maxing that bad boy out. And there were a couple of places on there where you could get one and it would be maxed out with software, maxed out with hardware, all this other high speed stuff. But I just didn't have a warm and fuzzy. You know, I was just like, I don't know what's going on here. You know, but I'm very quick to buy emblems and you know, hinges and parts for my cars off of eBay, and you know, I know it's going to come from somebody on the other side of the world who's going to stick it in a flat rate box and ship it to me.
Yeah,
you know, cool. Those things I'm good with, but you know, high end electronics, TVs, things like that, I wouldn't do.
Well, I guess that's how you feel about it. I mean, you know, you're entitled to your opinion, I guess. Yeah.
Oh, well, God, I feel an eBay song coming on.
What?
Clicking in the morning sun. I'll be checking in the evening call. Watching the bids roll in. Till the auction finally comes to an end. Yeah, I'm selling all my junk on eBay. Watching old time roll away.
Mr. Otis Redding.
I'm moving lots of crap on eBay.
It's wasting time.
Looks like some fool's gonna pay. Plastic toys McDonald's just gave away. I can't believe there's cat lids on Spider-Man under the hood. Well, I guess they don't mind the stains. A video of Barnaby Jones and this broken pair of Sony headphones. There's 2,000 pounds of foam and a small electric nose hair comb.
Aww.
Yeah, selling all my junk on eBay. If they don't buy it, I'll throw it away. Ooh, a useless cuckoo clock on eBay. It's sucker time.
See? What have you bought on eBay?
I've bought a lot of stuff on eBay, actually.
Like what?
What? A cuckoo clock? I would never buy nose hair clippers, though, on eBay. That's
horrible.
That was absolutely horrible. So, Charles and I are doing computer and technology news. I picked the story, so now you go. It's your turn.
Well, give me just one second here. I'm currently talking to someone on the Snapcard website to see if we can get an interviewee on the show. I know I could probably do this after the fact, but they've got one of these live chat things, and they work out well.
So you do that, and I'll go this. This is GameFront. Microsoft will give you $100. $100 for your PlayStation 3. Wow, not the 4 now, the 3. They're going to give you $100 for it. Now, according to the story, it says, now, ladies and gentlemen, the next stage of the console war between old rivals Microsoft and Sony is in full swing. Microsoft stores began a new deal this week that we could classify as a fired shot, okay? Right across the bow, evidently. If you give them a working PlayStation 3, it can't be malfunction, it has to be a working PlayStation 3, you'll get $100 off an Xbox One. What about that?
I do have to say something about the Xbox One.
What is that?
It's awesome.
All right.
I know people were freaking out because it like listens to you and it records your face and all this other stuff. But when you use that thing to the full potential, yeah, it is amazing to be able to walk into a room and be like, Xbox, yeah, watch television.
But you know, Grayson Hamilton, our gamer correspondent, he got a PlayStation 4.
I'm hoping to get one of those too.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm enjoying the Xbox so far for all the things that it does. But you know, the PS, the PlayStation 4, I am really looking forward to because I saw some of the graphics in demo mode and was just like, oh my God. So
well, they'll also take your Xbox 360s, S's and E's for that same amount of credit. It's not the greatest deal ever. You probably get a better deal on eBay. GameStop did better in November.
eBay.
If you're looking to make a move like today, you know, well, here it is, $100. Almost certainly, Microsoft will send these off to a third party that will dust them out and stock them at GameStop or Amazon, but it's still funny that they solicit PlayStation 3s. Microsoft would solicit it, you know. They ought to throw down $200 for PlayStation 4s just to see if anyone bites. No, I don't think that's going to happen. But there you go, $100 for your PlayStation 3.
Right on.
All right. You ready for another story?
One second. Hold on. Okay. Well, I mean, it's one of those interactive chats, and I know that they've got their chat thing on there, and I'm sure because they're like, well, where can we hear about what you guys are talking about SnapCard? And I'm like, well, we're live right now. Go to ComputerAmerica.com. And you know, the person's like, this is so cool. So well, like, wow, you know, it's you know, hi SnapCard, you know. But I think they would be somebody really cool to have on the show. So I'm going after that one. But in the meantime, you know, because I know I've got to do stories too, because I have to do my co-hostly duties. But we'll do this one because, you know, I am the hacker and these all interest me. But this one coming to you from computerworld.com. Do you use Yahoo?
Do I use Yahoo? I can't remember the last time I used Yahoo. It's been a long time.
Is that the one, the ID you have attached to your eBay account?
Yahoo!
Yahoo resets passwords after email hack. Yahoo suspects usernames and passwords were stolen from an unidentified third-party database. IGN News service, Yahoo has been resetting email accounts that were targeted in an attack apparently aimed at collecting personal information from recently sent messages, the company said Thursday. The list of usernames and passwords used for the attack was likely collected when another company's database was breached, said Yahoo's senior vice president. Said in a blog post. They didn't mention the third party or say how many accounts were affected. We're working with federal law enforcement to find and prosecute the perpetrators responsible for this hack, they continued on. The hacker used a malicious software program to access mail accounts with the stolen usernames and passwords. Now, this is entertaining because it's the second story in the same number of days where, you know, people have been cracking down and email hackers have just been getting just scooped up.
Sure.
You know, it's amazing. Free email services with larger user bases from companies like Yahoo, Google, and Microsoft are rich targets for hackers who use compromised accounts to deliver spam, launch attacks, and collect information. They didn't say when the attack occurred, and a Yahoo spokeswoman said that the company could not share more information while the investigation is ongoing. Yahoo said it's resetting passwords on the affected accounts and using second sign-on verification to let users re-secure their accounts. The feature sends a one-time passcode to a user's phone that must be entered into a web-based form to access the account. Yahoo has also implemented additional measures, to block attacks against Yahoo systems, end quote.
Okay.
You know, right. Yahoo advises that users change their passwords regularly and not reuse the same passwords for their Yahoo mail on other web services. And ending in their statement, the Yahoo spokesperson said, "We regret this has happened and want to assure our users that we take security of their data very seriously."
Yahoo! Well, there you go. All right. Good story. This is from BGR. PayPal says it didn't do it. Okay. GoDaddy partially admits helping a hacker. After an app developer revealed how a hacker managed to get access to his web properties and hold them for ransom by exploiting some potential security flaws in PayPal's and GoDaddy's customer identification policies, two companies have each commented on the matter. PayPal said in a blog post, that this gentleman's PayPal account has not been compromised, even though there was a failed attempt made to gain the customer's information by contacting PayPal.
No, wait, I'm going to interrupt you, and not because it has anything to do with this, but like I told you, I was talking to the Snapchat person on this, the SnapCard person on their website, right?
Yeah.
So they're listening in, and they're giving a shout out. They say, they said, "Oh, it's really cool, thank you," and they're saying, "Hi, mom." Isn't it amazing? Like, that's the first thing we always say when we're on television. We're like, "Hi, mom!" And, you know, dad's sitting back there like, "I taught you everything you know."
Exactly. The company added that it did not divulge any credit card details related to this account and that it did not divulge any personal or financial information related to this account. In other words, this was social engineering, right? Somebody just tried to pretend to be somebody else, right?
Yeah.
The
whole layout of the way that this all happened,
yeah,
was they got a little bit of information. They were able, and this is all related to a story that I don't think we did, but I think we were gonna do about the Twitter ID, the @N.
Yes, yes.
You know, that it was like $500,000 or a $50,000 Twitter ID, and what had happened is people had been trying to hack this guy for a long time. But they got a hold of PayPal, they got the last four digits of his credit card, and that was all the information that was necessary to call up GoDaddy, mm-hmm. tell them that they forgot all this information, or they have this, they've got the last four digits of the credit card, and then GoDaddy let them guess the first four digits.
Ouch. Oh.
And then gave them access to the account.
Well, the guy's name was, his last name was Hiroshima, which doesn't bode well.
I love that name.
Said the hacker told him that he was able to find out the last four digits of the card registered with PayPal by simply calling the company and successfully impersonating the developer. The Next Web reports that GoDaddy has sent in an official statement partially admitting that it helped the hacker gain access to Hiroshima's GoDaddy account, but said the person already had some of the information required to access the account. So why not just give him the rest, right? Okay. He said, here's a quote, our review of the situation reveals that the hacker was already in possession of a large portion of the customer information needed to access the account at the time he contacted GoDaddy. The hacker then socially engineered, there it is, see I said it, an employee to provide the remaining information needed to access the customer account. GoDaddy chief information security officer said the customer has since regained full access to his GoDaddy account, and we are working with industry partners to help restore services from other providers. We are making necessary changes to employee training to ensure we continue to provide industry-leading security to our customers and stay ahead of evolving hacker techniques. Meanwhile, Twitter has yet to come out with a public response on the matter. Hiroshima wrote on Twitter that the company simply ignored my claim and let somebody grab the .n, the rare Twitter handle object of the heist, freely. According to the developer, Twitter responded to his claim that, unfortunately, we're unable to verify you as the account holder and cannot assist you in accessing the account. Well, there it is.
Well, you know, I mean, first you have to think Twitter has these kind of requests that come to them all the time. You know, they see this type of stuff all the time. They see these different types of attacks, and people get things taken, and if you can't verify you are who you say you are, you know, they're just going to ignore you. But in this particular case, I mean, it was very valuable. It became very loud very quickly, and it's good to hear that he's working to get his stuff back. He got his domain retaken. You know, hopefully he can get his at end back. You know, it'll be good.
Yeah, I think it will. Okay. All right. We're at the bottom of the hour break. Where is the time going? Man, it's just flying
backwards.
By. Yeah, we are. That being a time traveler, you should be used to that.
And you are the time traveler.
I know, and I'm used to it.
You need to tell me what year we're getting our flying cars.
Oh.
Or go back and do some investing for me. Go back and find private Tendell and tell him to do that investment in Google.
HTML5 is in the news, too. We'll talk about that right after Patricia Reichel's London's Minute. We'll be right back.
Hey, everyone. Have you heard about the no-no hair removal device that's sweeping the globe? If you want to go weeks without shaving and get smooth, professional, quality results, here's our favorite host, Cheryl, for no-no hair removal.
Thanks. Hey, gals, I love talking about my no-no. It's this cute little hair removal system that you can take with you and use almost anywhere at home or on the road. No more expensive in-office treatments, painful waxing, and no more wasting your valuable time. Got unwanted facial hair? No-no has patented Thermacon technology that works on all hair and skin colors, so it's perfect for using on all body parts. And now you can take advantage of this incredible risk-free trial. Get the No-No, the facial kit, a travel case, and a $100 discount shopping card. And you don't risk a penny to try it. Try the incredible No-No hair completely risk-free. Call 1-800-953-5415. That's 800-953-5415. 800-953-5415.
Don't complain about your cable bill going up and up and up. Do something about it. Grab a pencil and jot down this special number. 1-866-663-MY-TV. The more cable TV rates go up, the better digital satellite TV looks. So, disable the cable and get more of your favorite channels in 100% digital quality for less money. Call 1-866-663-MYTV right now to sign up for packages starting as low as $19.99 and up to four rooms. And there's no equipment to buy. That includes your free HDTV upgrade, your free DVR upgrade, and your free professional installation. And the best part, the pristine digital picture and sound. Call 1-866-663-MYTV. So, what are you waiting for? Pull out your major credit or debit card. Call 1-866-663-MYTV. 1-866-663-MYTV. Disable the cable, cut costs, and get more. Call 1-866-663-MYTV. 1-866-663-MYTV.
You're back.
Hello, this is your London Minute, and I'm Patricia Reichel. During the next few weeks, Mr. Site will be sponsoring my London Minute. Let me introduce you as they host my website. MrSite.com is well known in the UK and Australia for website design and hosting. This is their 10th year in business, and I've been with them for the past 5. You can create your own website using their online tools. Or, if short on time, you can use their fantastic new Kickstart service. For a modest fee, a designer can build your site for you. No competitor, to my knowledge, does this. And great news, if you visit MrSite.com and enter the promo code London, MIN14, you will get an exclusive 20% off your purchase. It's for a limited time only. Take a peek at my recently revamped website, loveyourcomputer.co.uk, and click on the Mr. Site discount that's on the homepage. Tweet me at ComputerTweety if you think my new site is looking uber cool. This is Patricia Reichel for Computer America.
We always have to figure out who's going to do this one. But thanks, Patricia. We always enjoy the London Minute here on the Computer America Show. It is 33 minutes after the hour in the second hour of the Computer America Show. And Craig and I are doing computer and technology news brought to you by Slimware Utilities, the official optimization software of the Computer America Show. And, you know, if you guys want to get in on the conversation, you want to harass myself, you want to harass Craig, by the way, it is the you're an idiot, you know, attitude shirt tonight, so if you're paying attention, you know, give us a call, 347-884-8881, that's 347-884-8881, or go to computeramerica.com, click on the chat button, and join us in our live interactive add-on chat room, where you can get in on the conversation, and it looks like Eric's back!
Yes!
Eric's back in the into the chat room.
Wow! Well, we'll say hello.
He came back, he couldn't get enough of us.
Yeah, evidently not.
Yeah.
So, you know, that eBay parody that you did you like that or not?
I like eBay parodies. I mean, I like music. I like songs that do it. Yeah. Yeah. What?
Are you?
Oh, no.
I bought on eBay a house filled with this crap. Shows up in bubble wrap most every day. What I bought on eBay. Tell me why I need another pet rock. Tell me why I got that alpha alarm clock.
That's horrible.
I bid on Shatner's old toupee and had it on eBay. Your knickknack just checked. My feedback A plus. They all say they love me on eBay.
That's insane.
I'm slightly damaged golf bag to buy some Beanie Baby blue with hand from some guy I've never met in Norway. Found him on eBay.
I'm the type who is liable to snipe you with 2 seconds left to go.
Whoa, Doc PayPal or Visa, whatever'll please ya, as long as I've got the dough.
Your tchotchkes, sell me. Your watch, please. I'll buy.
I'm highest bidder. Just keep arriving in the mail. From that worldwide garage sale. Hey, it dudes, a peasant ashtray. Yeah, I bought it on eBay. Gotta buy a
A Kleenex used by Dr. Dre. Really? And welcome back to the Computer America Music Hour with DJ Craig Grossman.
What was that sound?
That was the turntable. That was me scratching on my turntable.
Okay.
Actually, I've got something for you. So we did a story recently, right, about Google buying Nest.
Yes, I remember.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm big on Google Plus, and you know, as a Glass Explorer, we've got a lot of stuff over there. But one of the people that I follow, who I followed from CES, who does a lot of tech reviews and a lot of other things, he's got this post, a gentleman by the name of Marcus Brownlee. It's a comic post, and if you're watching the video, you can see the comic post. There mm-hmm. we go. It's two guys sitting in their cubicle. Yeah. One guy turns to the other guy, and it says, "I think my Nest smoke alarm is going off. Google AdWords just pitched me a fire extinguisher and an offer for temporary housing."
What?
Because Google owns them, so now it's like, look, well, there's a problem going on. You know, I think your smoke alarm's going off. Here, we sell fire extinguishers, and here's some temporary housing just in case you need it.
Wow.
I mean, it brings to good light, you know, what is Google going to use Nest for? Like, what are they going to turn it into? You know, what's it going to become? Is it going to become, you know, just another avenue for them to market to you? Are they going to take the information that they know? You know, like, you've got one, don't you?
What, a Nest?
Yeah.
No, I don't have a Nest.
Oh, well, you know, think about this though. If you've got one and the temperature is always ridiculously hot in your house and yeah. Google knows this,
yeah.
What if they pitch you an ad for air conditioning?
Oh my goodness.
You know, like, isn't that's just a little above and beyond. I mean, like, I get creeped out when I do tiny little searches on something and I inadvertently click on one of those ads and that ad haunts me for the next 3 weeks.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, yeah, but it's Google. Who knows?
What does your T-shirt say? I'm looking at you. What is it?
When you figure out what vowels you have to buy.
Oh, okay. All right, good enough.
So I finished the Yahoo password reset story. Is your turn? My turn.
Yes. HTML5 apps price apps to sell at the same price as counterparts. Now developers building HTML5 applications are permitted to price apps to sell just the same as coded counterparts thanks to Amazon making changes to its app store. Now, prior to today, all HTML5 apps were automatically set to quote-unquote free when added to the App Store. Last August, web developers had a way to turn their web applications and mobile sites into Android apps. These apps are able to be downloaded anywhere Amazon App Store can run, including smartphones and tablets. Developers wanted to use this option so they could simply submit their URLs and Amazon would do all the work of packaging the apps in the correct format. Huh. For the average consumer, it would be difficult to tell the difference between native and HTML5 format apps. They are not listed separately, so it makes them very hard to spot. Amazon didn't divulge how many HTML5 apps they were making available today. They want to entice you to go to the site yourself.
I mean, I don't agree with them charging the same for HTML5 apps.
Why?
It doesn't take the same level of coding, and you can convert just about any website you can make into an HTML5 website with two clicks.
That's the beauty of HTML5, and it's supposed to be replacing all this Java stuff and all these Flash and everything. You can now do it. You can just be an HTML5. You know,
right? But what used to take, you know, a few hours to code an effective app, I can do in a moment.
Yeah.
Oh, Jonathan, I'm gonna get that shirt. It's out there somewhere, but it would be perfect for me. Jonathan in the chat room says that I need an ID, India Delta, 10-T t-shirt.
ID 10?
ID 10-T.
ID 10-D.
ID, India Delta,
yeah,
Tango Echo November, hyphen, Tango.
Yeah, I get it.
Now, if you were to write it down, you put ID, the number 10.
Yeah.
You know, 10.
Yeah.
What is it?
ID 10-T.
What does it say?
I don't know.
It says idiot.
Oh.
If you look at the chat room, it's ID10T.
Yeah.
There you go.
Thanks.
And actually, you know, the history behind my attitude shirts.
Yeah.
Many years ago, when I was working for a large aircraft manufacturing company, mm-hmm. a colleague of mine and I actually did. Do you know what a NetSend is?
NetSend. Now, what is NetSend?
Well, it's in the Windows world, in the older NT world. You were able to send pop-up messages from one terminal to another terminal via the network using the NetSend command.
Yes, I remember that.
We had this enabled. I don't know why it was enabled, but it was enabled, and we were messing with one of our testers. And he was one of those very serious gentlemen who always talk like this, and he never smiled.
Yeah.
You know, and we were like, okay, let's see if we can cheer this guy up or we can do something and make everybody laugh. So we sent him a message, then pop up, and then the error window pops up. It says, error, ID 10T.
Yeah.
You know, an error has been detected between your keyboard and chair. Please remove the error and try again. He sat there for like 2 minutes, staring at the screen, and then he proceeds to point at the screen, or point at the keyboard, and then point at the chair, and then verbally out loud to a room of testers goes, "How does the computer know about the chair?"
Oh, my gosh.
We were holding it in. We were trying not to laugh. And we just fell out, hit the floor laughing. And he got so mad that he reported us to his boss. Our boss came down on us. Well, our boss pretended to come down on us.
Yeah.
He called us into his office, and he was like, "And okay, I'm going to yell at you, but that's the funniest thing I have seen happen in this area in years. So don't think I'm yelling at you. Just look sad when you walk out, because he's going to be still standing there." And he yelled at us for like 2 minutes, and then we walked out. We got back to our office, and we went back to laughing. It was just perfect.
Oh, gosh. Well, anyway, HTML5. How many people have asked us to get an HTML5 chat room?
I get it. I've asked us.
Yeah, I know, but I've talked to the add-on chat room guy. His name is Chris, and he says that they're going to be coming out with an HTML5 version of the chat room, and I will rejoice on that day.
That's the thing. I mean, HTML5 is like, I got a call yesterday, maybe today, from someone who I was working on a project with about a year ago, and the technology, or a year and a half ago, and the technology has advanced so far. We were developing mobile apps, and where we stalled was we didn't have a mobile app developer. You know, but right then and there, I was like, actually, I have an idea. And I went and I did a couple of clicks and developed a website that when you put it onto a mobile phone, when you put it on an iPhone, you put it on an Android phone or any type of phone, it pops up and it flows and moves just like a mobile app, just like like it downloaded it from the App Store.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so now they don't have to download an app. We don't have to do any of that stuff. They get it. They enter in their information. They link it with their Facebook profile. And now they can buy hot dogs at just about any stadium in the world.
That's great. Yeah. But did you see the IM I sent you on the chat room? So you'll see it explains it.
Oh,
yeah. Okay.
I need that T-shirt.
Yeah. SwiftKey partners with Evernote. Do you use Evernote?
I do. Well, sort of.
I mean, I like it. I understand it. I have never really had a use for it, but I can certainly understand how people can find that probably one of the most wonderful, useful apps to really get themselves organized.
I mean, Evernote.
It's great. It's really. It's one of the great apps. I absolutely think so.
I have to go back and revisit it.
Yeah.
But I think I substituted Evernote with the Notes with Google Keep on my Android devices and the Notes app on the Apple devices.
Yeah. Well, Mashable came out with the story. SwiftKey partners with Evernote is going to launch an iOS app. SwiftKey. The company behind Android's most popular keyboard has teamed up with Evernote to launch its first iOS app, the SwiftKey Note. The note-taking app rolled out today, and unlike SwiftKey's flagship Android app, it's free. The app combines Evernote's cloud-backed platform and SwiftKey's ultra-fast predictive keyboard to create a simple note-taking app that can sync your notes across all of your connected devices. Isn't that cool? The app comes on the heels of Evernote's recent news that its sync services is now 4 times faster. Now, unlike Evernote's mobile offering, SwiftKey Note takes a more minimalist approach to note-taking, one that emphasizes usability and typing speed over formatting and other advanced features. Evernote has a platform that allows developers to work quite deeply into the way in which you store notes and back them up, SwiftKey's chief marketing officer said in an interview with Mashable. But one of the things that the default Evernote apps aren't necessarily great at is quick
simple note entry. The idea that you could quickly create a note and it shows up in the Evernote platform and you can use it on any of your devices was something that got quite a bit of momentum, a lot of momentum with Evernote. So there, it's kind of cool. You know, I have to say I've used it, but I find myself now using a verbal. I mean, I don't type as much. I with my iPhone, my gold iPhone 5S, I just tap on the little microphone and speak it, and everything comes out, you know? I just find it easier to do than to physically type.
Well, I mean, there are some occasions where I just don't want to type, back that one up. I don't want to talk because, you know, it's still kind of private, you know? We were standing in the eyeglass place today, and everybody and you know, my wife looks at me and I say, hey, can you look up the number to the 1 hour place so that we can get these lenses today? And she's like, you know, you've got this awesome technology on your head. Why don't you just tell it to do it? And in the back of my head, I'm thinking, well, one, because I'm standing in the middle of his office, and all of these ladies here are like, you know, we want to help you. And I'm like, I just want to get out of here so that I can get, you know, my lenses in this thing faster, so I don't have to have them out of my possession for a couple of days, you know. And I'm like, you know, it's just certain occasions where I just don't want to sit there and say, you know, this is what I want to do. You know, like, could you imagine sitting in a restaurant and being like, you know, okay, Glass, do a Yelp review on this crappy restaurant?
No, you probably wouldn't want to do that.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to do that. So there are just times where I just don't want to talk. But I never did get on the swipe, but the predictive text, if they can fix that, because there's an entire website dedicated to stupid autocorrects.
Yeah.
You know, I just wouldn't want to spend too much extra time going back and reviewing and fixing my mini mistakes, you know?
Okay. All right, well, why don't you do the next story?
Okay. This is from a website that I have never heard of before, but I think it's owned by AOL because it's got AOL tech at the top of it. It's TUAW.com. You know, Facebook introduces paper for iPhone coming February 3. Today, Facebook announced its latest standalone app, Paper, launching exclusively on iOS on February 3rd. The app provides an optimized version of your newsfeed that allows you to quickly scroll through posts and curate news stories with larger quality images and text. Did I say that right? Yeah. You can customize what will show up on your feed using a feature called Sections, which will allow you to choose from a number of genres of stories, such as headlines, creators, and flavors.
Okay.
If the app works as prescribed, it is possible you can expect it to become a replacement for the current Facebook mobile app.
Wow.
Utilizing too bad I don't use a Facebook, but this is who it reminds me of. Utilizing a news feed that owes a lot to Flipboard and the ability to post images, stories, and statuses directly to your page. The app looks like an idealized version of what your current feed is supposed to be currently providing.
Wow.
You know, Paper is controlled via gestures, so there is a bit of a learning curve. However, the app has a heads-up display that will pop up to teach you when you start out. Your feed is shown via a series of story cards demonstrated in the video below.
Yeah, that's okay.
You can either scroll through your cards one by one or in a feed. When you select a card, the story takes over your whole screen. You'll see your friend's new photo album in an optimized view alongside curated news stories targeted at your interests.
It looks really nice.
Have you ever used Flipboard?
No, I have not used Flipboard.
Oh, that is an app you need to install on your phone right now.
Am I going to iPhone 5S?
Yes. That's the first time you've said it, and we are 51 minutes into the second hour. I am very proud of you.
No, it's the second time, actually. I snuck one by.
You snuck one in?
Yeah, I did.
Oh.
You missed that one.
Yeah, but, you know, the Flipboard, you need to fix that. You need to correct that problem right now. What are your favorite news sources?
CNN is the one that I usually go to.
Okay, CNN, anybody else?
Fox News.
Okay.
CBS sometimes.
Okay, so with Flipboard, imagine if you could have the news feeds from all of those in like a digital newspaper.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what Flipboard does. You get it, you have the option, you can sign up for an account so that you can transfer this from one device to another very seamlessly, Or you can just set it up individually on your phone without signing up or giving any information, and you can add CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, all these other ones, TechCrunch, Tech News stuff, the Computer America RSS feed.
We do have that.
See?
We have
it. You can add that to your phone, and you can flip through it like you're flipping through the pages of a newspaper. It is a gorgeous little app. I love it. You know, it's always been something that I use. I use it because, you know, LinkedIn feeds, and, you know, you get information from everywhere.
Sure, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's just, you should definitely fix that. I mean, it's a pity. I don't use Facebook. You know? But, you know, if Facebook is stealing from it, you know, it's got to be good.
Yeah, I would think so.
I think we have time for one, maybe two more.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Let me go to this one. Now, Samsung, the Galaxy, you know, there's more rumors, okay, about the Galaxy S5, okay? It says rumors are heating up about the Galaxy S5, and you may see for the phone's predecessor, the Galaxy S4, Samsung held a glitzy launch event of its own, but there is some indication that the Samsung will be at least offering a peek at its major product in the February trade show instead. Wow. A recent report from Bloomberg indicates the device will have an April release, fitting into the schedule that the Korean smartphone titan has set in the past. Bloomberg also reports that the newest model in the Galaxy line will support a fingerprint reader and an all-new design. As we talked about that last night. The move from the Galaxy S3 to the Galaxy S4 was not dramatic, and the phones look pretty similar. While the S4 introduced a lot of new features, such as a scrolling feature that detects when you're looking at the screen, I really like that. Did you ever use that, by the way?
What?
Well, you know, look at the screen and it would scroll, you know, when you were looking at it.
I did. That's the thing about the S4, is there were so many features packed into that thing.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, Gene and I had this conversation. It was packed full of features that were awesome in concept, but you would never use on a daily basis. The only two that I used often were the IR blaster. Loved that because I could control anything, and that just, you know, pissed off everyone anywhere. Mm-hmm. And the smart look, the iWatch, whatever it was, when you look away from the screen, how it would pause a video, or it would know that you were there, or wouldn't dim or do stuff like that. That was a really nifty feature. But a lot of the other ones were like it scrolled with the movement of your head.
I like when you're watching a movie and you turn your eyes away, the movie pauses.
Yeah, that was one of my favorite features. That is one of my favorite features of the S4.
When you play with that at first, you know, you would stop. Stopping and starting the movie just to see it happen, you know. That was cool. Anyway, basically the gist of this is that Samsung and Google are announcing a patent cross-licensing deal that paves the way for a deeper collaboration on development projects. Said this could include having Samsung alter the look of its devices to better fit Google's vision. So in all likelihood, that means that future Samsung phones, perhaps including the S5, will sport software that looks more like Google's own version of Android than it has in the past. So that's the rumor for this Android, the S5, at this point.
There's only one?
There's only one at this point.
That's horrible. You would think there would be more rumors. You know, didn't they say that, they said there was a fingerprint reader, it's supposed to be a metal back, it's supposed to be, like, this one is, like, they're finally catching up in version numbers, so it's the 5S and the S5.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're supposed to be coming more hardcore at Apple.
Yeah.
Interesting, you know, random bit of trivia. Do you know who created the chip that powers all of your Apple devices?
Samsung.
Exactly.
Okay, you got me to admit it.
They're in bed with one another.
They're suing each other. Would you use a camera that takes 360-degree panoramas?
Probably.
Ricoh's got a $400 camera called the Theta. It's an innovative gadget that allows you to capture 360-degree spherical panoramas with just a single click of a button.
I think I could totally see in 500 or 600 different places where this would be perfect.
Okay, like where?
Let's see, virtual tours.
Super Bowl.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that would be cool.
Yeah. Are you watching the Super Bowl this weekend?
I like to watch the commercials. I record it, then I fast forward to the game and then stop. Oh, there's a commercial, and I watch.
You fast forward through the game to watch the commercials.
I love the commercials.
Oh my goodness!
They're so creative and different.
Well, Well, you're not going to miss anything. I mean, I am secretly, and anybody who's listening in Denver, don't find me. You know, I'll find you. I am secretly hoping that the Broncos don't win.
Okay. Anyway, Ricoh has teamed up with Google to allow you to actually do something with these panoramas, and you can put them up on Google Maps and Google Plus. Isn't that okay?
So this
this new feature comes through Ricoh, making its images compatible with Google's Photosphere XMP format, which is natively used in a number of Android phones. Updated software for iOS, Android, and computers now means that the Theta can save its photospheres in this format and upload them to Google Maps or Google Plus. You can then link multiple of these panoramas together to create your own street view, which Google calls a constellation. So that means you can wander around your neighborhood, your favorite park, or anywhere else you might like. I do that anyway. Snapping pictures of your mobile.
You just wander around because your wife has kicked you out.
You can then upload them to Google Maps and make your own private walking tour. That's kind of cool. If you have friends coming to visit you in your city, you could put together a Google Street View tour and a set of directions so they know what they're looking at. But as nice as this feature is, $400 is still a very steep price for something that most people can just do with their smartphones, even if it means taking
90 seconds
compared to the just seconds the Ricoh Theta can do.
Yep.
No, it's there. Well, I think it's kind of cool. Hey, you know, guess what? We're out of time. This show just flew on by.
It's amazing how that happens when you're engaged and involved.
Yes, it is. Coming up tomorrow night, we're going to have one of our correspondents on the show, Michael Miller, is going to be on here. This guy is amazing. He's the author of over 150 books. 150. He's written over
160 seconds.
And he's written like the complete idiot guide to Google Plus. He's written all kinds of technology books and non-technology books too. And he was with us on the last show of the year, Mike Miller.
And this is the first one back.
Yeah, not the first one, but certainly in the first month. And he's going to be here. He's always with us on the last Friday of every month. And we're going to have some interesting topics to talk about. He's going to be on with us for both hours on the Computer America show. Again, just want to welcome all of our new listeners at the IRN Radio Network and, of course, The Boost and Blog Talk Radio. And we will see you tomorrow night.
We will.
Yeah, so until tomorrow night, this is Craig Crossman hoping that your hard disk never becomes floppy.
Because it gets sold on eBay if it does.
10 seconds.
We'll see you tomorrow night.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
There you go.
There we are.
And that was a good show tonight.
It was. It was a good one.
Yeah.
Let me see. If the Hangout is still going. There we go. Plan a Hangout. Ooh.
What?
No, I clicked a different button.
And
it set up the Hangout slightly different than everything else. This event will be online. Details, invitees.
So yeah, if you can help me figure out what's going on with that.
Hold on, let me get this stream finished. I don't think that's going to bother anybody. We can take a look at it. Give me a second.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay, I'll do this one. Let's see. Computer America. Did I spell that right? Computer America. With Mike Miller.
Hey, let me get this stream finished. I don't think that's going to
work. You're watching it?
Yeah.
Okay, give me a second.
Yeah. Is the camera still on or you turned it off? The
camera's still running right now.
Oh, okay.
I got five people watching still. Hi, everyone.
Hello, everybody. It's behind the scenes at Computer America.
Behind the scenes at Computer America.
We can find out the real Computer America, what goes on.
Yeah. This is where the clothes come off. Wait.
Oh! No,
wait, wrong kind of show. Let's see.
Let me get this stream finished. I don't think that's going to
work. You're watching it?
Yeah. Okay, you're sending me the code for the new...
I'm working on it right now.
You are? All right. More contest entries here. Jeez.
Mike is an author of over, you said 30 books on...
50 books. 150. He's written over 150.
150 books on technology.
No, and non-technology things as well.
All sorts of things.
Yeah.
All right. We're not going to invite anyone. We're going to change the theme a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
We will do it as... What do I want to do? Not birthday.
Birthday?
Yeah, you can change different themes for the type of hangout.
Okay.
It's kind of cool. That'll do. Yeah. So the theme. Not inviting anyone. Public. Done. And done.
Okay.
All right, that's there.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I'm going to turn the stream off now. Good night, everyone, you five viewers.
Oh.